my heart. Keep me singing, 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 keep me singing till the break of day. And I will sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna to the King of Kings. And I will sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna to the King. Give me peace in my heart, keep me resting, 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 give me peace in my heart.
In the West, there are still a few good men left. Men of God, like the circuit riding preachers of old. Proclaiming truth like the holy prophets of old. Strong and bold. You're about to hear politically incorrect, but biblically correct truth from circuit riding preacher Peter Peters, whose home base is a radio ranch nestled in the Laramie River Valley near Laramie, Wyoming. The Radio Ranch is a working cattle and horse ranch where circuit riding preacher Peter Peters broadcasts nightly worldwide on the Scriptures for America Worldwide Broadcasting Network, reaching the world through satellite, radio, television, shortwave, and the World Wide Web. Riding for the brand, he preaches for the man, Jesus Christ, the Son of God. His circuit not only includes a radio ranch outreach in Wyoming, but also the LaPorte Church of Christ, located at the base of the colorful Colorado Rocky Mountains in LaPorte, Colorado, where he has preached for over 30 years. The messages preached there by Dr. Peters on Sunday morning are streamed live on the internet and are archived at the ministry website, scripturesforamerica.org. Dr. Peters' politically incorrect but biblically correct sermons are available on CD and DVD. Many in America, Canada, and all over the world are on the free CD and DVD ministry. Our address will be given at the end of this broadcast. And now, here is Dr. and Pastor Peter John Peters with the Word of God.
Thank you, Lord. We've got much to be thankful for, as old Brother Claus would say. We're grateful. And Lord, I'm grateful for mothers. How bad we need them in this land. And I know there are some don't have their mamas anymore. Lord, I'm grateful for Christian mothers. Raise their children faithful. And their children know they'll be seeing their mother on the other side of Jordan. And I'm grateful the way you paid that price to make that possible. Lord, grant a blessing now on this Mother's Day message. I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. There's a passage in Galatians chapter 4, verse 16. I'm sure some of you are saying, Pastor Peters, do you enjoy making people angry? Do you enjoy making enemies, Pastor Peters? Most people want to be loved. Most people want to be accepted. Well, I'm like most people, but I'll have to tell you, people, I do enjoy it. If the truth makes you angry. Because I enjoy telling the truth. Truth is, as it says in Galatians, Paul said, "Have I therefore become your enemy by telling you the truth?" And when you live in a society that would rather believe the lie than the truth, yeah, you can become people's enemies. No, I really don't want to be someone's enemy. But I want to love the truth, and I want you to love the truth. And I just thought I'd bring a message, be easy today, called Truths for Mother's Day. Give you some stories, and first of all, I'm going to give you this truth about Mother's Day. I suspect Mother's Day is a Babylonian marketing ploy. I knew it. You couldn't even take one day. A Babylonian marketing ploy where they market eating out, sale of flowers, sale of gift cards and jewelry. It's an economic shot in the arm. You can bet your boots and throw in your spurs on that one in this Babylonian day. I knew he'd have something bad to say. I didn't say. I wasn't in favor of it. I'm just telling you the truth about Mother's Day. And I think it's a good day. One of the few good points of Babylon. Because it's a day where people remember to say, "Mother, I love you." And I'm thinking about this cartoon. This cartoon seems to be fitting on Mother's Day. I think we can bring it on the screen. Little girl says, "You know, it's really weird. Sometimes my friends act all nice to me and ask me to help them with stuff. And other times they act like I don't even exist. I'm telling you this because I heard that you have the same problem with some people." Now, how does that apply to Mother's Day? It's a sad situation when love has grown so cold, where so little is told to mothers, "I love you." At least when it comes to Mother's Day, they marketing ploy or not, it's a day where mothers get to hear from their children, "I love you." Now, some of you mothers out there, I'm going to talk to you right now. I know that some of you are not hearing from your children because they are so caught up and so deluded and so taken by the deceptions of the devil himself that they don't recognize what they got right now. But if it's any consolation, as far as a consolation prize goes, they'll figure it out someday. Most likely the day when it's too late. But they'll figure it out. And I want you to figure out that maybe you've been singled out to suffer a little bit. There's nothing wrong with suffering. It's God's plan. And when you're called, it's very interesting to read how many times the Bible talks about how it's a joy to be counted worthy to suffer for the cause of Christ. And some of you Christian mothers, I know you suffer. Because they don't call you. They don't contact you. And I understand. And the Lord understands. And that's why I brought up that cartoon. He understands. But I want you to understand, I'm not against Mother's Day. I'm for it. Because that's the day when at least so many people call and say, "Mom, I love you." And we had a happy announcement today in Sunday school, adult and young people Sunday school class. A couple got engaged last night. And so I thought I'd tell you the story. I said I'd be telling you stories. You want to hear more stories today? Would you like to hear stories today? I'll tell you about the old Canaanite slut dog that I performed the marriage for. Okay? Yeah, the Bible talks about the Canaanites. That's what it says. Bible calls Canaanites dogs. I think that's where you get that term. She's nothing but a dirty, you know what? There's plenty of them in society. Now, the Bible says that in the last days, we'd have a society that they would not endure sound doctrine. They won't have itching ears and accumulate to themselves teachers after their own desires to hear what they want to hear. But you're in the wrong place. Turn the dial or switch the channel or whatever it might be, because you're going to hear what the Word of God says. Now, the Word of God points out that a worthy woman is a rare thing. But God's got them, and I want you as women to go and be one of them, and men to be not one of them, be a man. But that's what God wants, you see. He's got a plan, and His plan is an order. Now, we're living in Babylon, which is an order that's out of order with God right now. The order that God has is Christ is the head of every home. And then the husband, then the wife, and then the children. And it should be a happy home. Well, the Bible says in the last days, love would grow cold. And sin causes love to grow cold. Hope you have a love for the truth. The truth is, this is a true story. It was out in Wisconsin, and this couple was going, they had gotten engaged. And they were coming to this gathering we had to get married. And so I thought it'd be a good time to bring a sermon on love. And I pointed out that when you're in love, I was going to use an illustration. Now, this was my theory. My theory was, when you are in love, you smile. I want the young lady that was proposed to, I don't want her put on the screen, but I want you to stand up right now. Now turn around and look at the crowd. What do you see on her face? A smile. Well, as you see, that's the idea, is that you're supposed to be happy and smiling when you're in love and you're going to get married. And so in this sermon I come up with, I was going to use this illustration, and so I had her stand up. I want you to stand up, and I want you to stand up, the two of them. Okay, you proposed to her last night. Now turn and look at her. All right? Now see how they both smile. They can't help but smile at one another. Okay, you may be seated. Aren't you glad I didn't show that to the whole world? So I did the same thing out there at that camp. I said, I want you two to stand up and look at each other. Boy, you talk about a sermon illustration falling flat on its face. There was no smiles. Do you remember that, Richard? And then we performed the wedding about that was on a Friday night. We performed it on a Sunday and had all these wedding pictures taken in the pine trees there of Wisconsin. And, you know, I looked at those photos and there wasn't a smile one on her face ever. And well, how did the marriage turn out, Pastor Peters? How do you think it turned out? You know, when that young couple I just had stand here someday walk up the aisle and get married, if there's a wedding march, if that's what's going to be part of their wedding, I want to tell you this. There'll be off in the corner a cat. He thinks he's a pretty cool cat. And he's cleaning his eye teeth, and his tail's a flipping, keeping beat with the music. And he's called a lion. And the Bible speaks of him as the devil, who is a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. And the first thing he attacked, as you read the Word of God, was the marriage that God had put together. Now, have I become your enemy by telling you the truth? I hope not, because I'm really not your enemy. God's your enemy, because He's not going to change. He's going to tell you the truth. You're going to have to change. He doesn't change. Heaven and earth might pass away, the Bible says, but His Word will abide forever. And His Word shows us that on the eighth day He created Adam. And there was Adam and Eve. And let me tell you about the first marriage. That'll make a lot of you mad. I got an email the other day and somebody said, you know, you need to look at yourself. You know, the demons must come into you because you get angry from the pulpit. Where in the world do you get the idea that you're never to be angry at sin? Amen? A bunch of zombies out there expecting the preacher to be zombie-like as well. I want to tell you something. It's a sin when the marriage is not between a man and a woman. Now, the first marriage was between a man and a woman. Now, that'll make a lot of people mad right there. Anything that doesn't fit that is not a valid marriage in the eyes of God. Can you accept that? Whether you accept it or not, that's your problem, not mine. My problem ceased once I tell you the truth. You want more truth in regards to first marriage? Or is that enough? Well, they were both the same color. Oh, now you're getting really, really bad here, Pastor Peters. I knew you'd take a Mother's Day sermon and get people upset. Well, we need families again in this land. Godly families. Man and woman, wherein the law of God is carried on of kind after kind. Do we not? I don't know where it's at in Scripture. Don't even know if I wrote it down. But it is in Scripture somewhere. Let's try this Scripture. Let's go to Genesis 24, 1 through 4, since I've already gotten people now on the track of being angry. If you're a mother and father, you be praying for your children that they marry someone of the opposite sex, of the same race, and the same faith. That would be wise. And that's a Mother's Day truth that I feel led to give you. And that goes clear back to the book of Genesis, chapter 24. Let's read it. Now Abram was old, advanced in age, and the Lord had blessed Abraham in every way. And Abraham said to his servant, the oldest of his household, who had charge of all that he owned, "Please place your hand under my thigh, and I will make you swear by the Lord, the God of heaven and the earth, that you shall not take a wife for my son from the daughters of the Canaanites among whom I live. But you will go to my country and to my relatives and take a wife for my son Isaac." Well, he wanted the family unit to go on. Now, today, what would he be called? He'd be called a racist. In fact, there's an article that... Well, let me just show it to you. It says, this was Newsweek. Is your baby racist? Exploring the roots of discrimination. Isn't it interesting they put a white baby up there when they say, is your baby racist? All I can say is, I hope to God so. Because I don't want to raise a bunch of mongrels for grandchildren. Boy, have I become your enemies for telling you the truth? That truth is not proclaimed. Is that the truth that Abraham had? Absolutely. He wanted to follow kind after kind. There you have it. I could give you some other truths. Might do it as I go on that make you angry. Let me give you some truths that shouldn't make you too angry. But it'll make you angry as well. This week I did some traveling. And I was surprised to see, as I was going through the airport, how many women were carrying around a magazine called Glamour. And the reason that magazine kind of grabbed my eye, let me defend myself, is because I was at a TV set in the morning having one of those screens were going. I wasn't watching per se, but it was Good Morning America or something like that. And they had Glamour magazine showed up there, and this Glamour magazine was called the New Sexy Girl, or something like that. Is that what it is, Richard and Jason?
I put it on the screen if you like. I brought my copy.
Richard brought his copy. I got Jason's. It was sad to me, because I thought how the flesh marketers are deceiving these young ladies, using them. And they don't know that the vanity of life is so fleeting. And I was surprised, because I watched that thing, and here they were showing this on Good Morning America, and these girls that got to be models on this thing. And then I saw them carrying around in the airport, and I thought, my. You know, if they were to take and put in, just put in Proverbs 31, and had a, just Proverbs 31 in Glamour magazine, people would be angry. What is Proverbs 31, you say? It's God's description of the worthy woman. And it's quite a description. I brought to the pulpit on Mother's Day this article called Just a Mom. I want to read it to you. It says, a woman renewing her driver's license at the county clerk's office was asked by the woman recorder to state her occupation. She hesitated, uncertain how to classify herself. What I mean is, explained the recorder, do you have a job or are you just a... Of course I have a job, snapped the woman. I'm a mom. We don't list moms as an occupation. Housewife covers it, said the recorder emphatically. I forgot all about her story until one day I found myself in the same situation, this time at our own town hall. The clerk was obviously a career woman, poised, efficient, and possessed of a high-sounding title like official interrogator or town register. What is your occupation? She probed. What made me say it, I do not know. The word simply popped out. I'm a research associate in the field of child development and human relations. The clerk paused, ballpoint pen frozen in midair, and looked up as though she had not heard right. I repeated the title slowly, emphasizing the most significant words. Then I stared with wonder as my pronouncement was written in bold black ink on the official questionnaire. Might I ask, said the clerk with new interest, just what do you do in your field? Coolly, without any trace of fluster in my voice, I heard myself reply, I have a continuing program of research. What mother doesn't? In the laboratory and in the field. Normally, I would have said indoors and outdoors. I'm working for my master's, parentheses, first the Lord and then the whole family, and already have 4 credits, parentheses, all daughters. Of course, the job is one of the most demanding in the humanities. Any mother care to disagree? And I often work 14 hours a day, parentheses, 24 is more like it. But the job is more challenging than most run-of-the-mill careers. And the rewards are more of a satisfaction than just money. There was an increasing note of respect in the clerk's voice as she completed the form, stood up, and personally ushered me to the door. As I drove into our driveway, I buoyed up by my glamorous new career. I was greeted by my lab assistants, ages 13, 7, and 3. Upstairs, I could hear our new experimental model, a 6-month-old baby, in the child development program, testing out new vocal patterns. I felt I had scored a beat on bureaucracy, and I had gone on the official record as someone more distinguished and indispensable to mankind than just another mom. Motherhood, what a glorious career. Amen. Isn't that good? Mothers, I tip my hats to you. I've never been one that... I've always marveled at a mother's love and what they go through. And I think kingdom truth is this. Even though it might be a Babylonian day, it's a good day because at least it's one day that some moms will get a phone call and say, "Mom, I love you," or a card or something like that. I don't know if you know how it was once was in this land, but I remember back in the 50s how it was, and motherhood was entirely different. Now, I sent a Mother's Day card to a lady. She's not my mother, but I just always send her a Mother's Day card every Mother's Day. She was my buddy's mother, and I was just a stray, like a stray cat. She'd always let me sit down and meal with them. I used to always marvel about the family and that my buddy had. Bert's family had a mom and a dad. He had a clean shirt to wear to school every day. She always made sure he was washed behind the ears. And he had to brush his teeth, comb his hair, and always had a meal waiting for him. She always had extra food when I was there. And she was just a fine mother. But there were mothers like that all over the place back in the 50s. I mean, that was the standard. There weren't very many latchkey kids, as I remember, in the 50s. There were moms and there were dads. It wasn't that way necessarily at my house, but I always liked going to their house. In fact, she would go when they would have these parent-teacher conferences, since my buddy, her son, was in my class, and nobody went to hear what I had to do in school. She always sat in after she went to her, heard about her son. Then she would go and she would listen to the teacher tell about me. And so I just kind of always, all through the years, sent her a card on Mother's Day and thanked her for sharing her life as a mother. But that's the way it was back in the 50s. And I got an article. It's an actual article. And today it's laughed at. But this is an actual article that was in the good 1955 Good Housekeeping article. You see, I've told you from this pulpit that the Amalekites steal. They steal your women and your children. And when I brought out that treatise called Revealing the Man of Sin, the Man of Lawlessness, the Man of 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 that sits in the temple, we pointed out that that man is Esau. More specifically, you can be sure it's Amalek, who was the grandson of Esau. And when David came home to Ziklag, expecting to be greeted with a hug and a kiss by his wife, he found she'd been taken by the Amalekites. And all the men that were with him found that their women and their children had been taken by the Amalekites. There's a reason that story is in the Scriptures. There's a reason the Scripture says that God will always have war with Amalek. Well, where is Amalek today? I'm telling you, he's in the pulpits. You know that church down there in Colorado Springs where that preacher was caught with a faggot. Well, I forget the name of that guy. Haggard? Yeah. That church, I understand, if I think I got my facts right, because talking to a man there, it's not that one, it's one like that one. They actually have, it's a big church, and they actually have a program for women that want to leave their husbands. They've got a help program where they can contact attorneys and they can get assistance in getting a divorce. This is the stealing of the women. Now, the Scriptures talk about this stealing that's going on, but it speaks about it in this way. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, I want to read 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 6 and 7. It says, For among them are those who enter into households and captivate weak women weighed down with sin, led on by various impulses, always learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. This captivity is a different kind of captivity than it went on in the days of David. It's a captivity of the mind. You don't want to just be a housewife. You don't want to just be a mother. You want something glamorous. Wouldn't you like to be a flag girl out on a road crew where it's hot and burning sun and you can wiggle your little butt when they go by? Huh? And then you're liberated. Come on, babe. I mean, it's really that bad. Well, this is what was like in the 50s. This was the Good Housekeeping article. The Good Wife Guide. Have dinner ready. Plan ahead, even the night before, to have a delicious meal ready on time for his return. This is a way of letting him know that you have been thinking about him and are concerned about his needs. Prepare yourself. Take 15 minutes to rest so you'll be refreshed when he arrives. Touch up your makeup and put a pink ribbon. Put a ribbon in your hair. And this one. Be a little gay and a little more interesting for him. Clear away the clutter. I mean, there's a whole list of things. If I really wanted to make you mad, I could read the whole thing. It would literally make women mad. And the next thing they'll say, well, what about the mayor? You see, you don't understand. These things have had an effect. All these TV programs, all these glamour magazines, all the non-preaching of the Word of God from the pulpits. I want you to know that we're living in an hour, which is called the Day of the Lord. And if you can't see the Day of the Lord events that are happening about us, you're a blinded person. You need to, as Peter said, you need to be living in all godliness and virtue. And so I pray for that there'll someday be homes like this again. Homes that I remember back in the 50s. This is Spiritual Truths for Mother's Day. I want us to go to a spiritual truth, because we're living in a day and age where Satan has broken the families and shattered them in so many ways. When that young couple comes up the aisle, there are, you know, we need to pray for them, because, first of all, just kingdom economics. When I was coming out of the airport there in Denver, you got to go through all these, you got to drive out of there if you parked your car in the parking lot. And I was looking at every one of those people in those booths there that take the tickets. You couldn't find one white man in the group. Not one. And if you walk around and look at the vending shops in that airport, you can't find one that's run by a white man. The closest thing you'll find that has anything to do with white business, and I don't think it's there now, it used to be, was a shoe shine station that had all white women. Now, those jobs are divvied out by a discriminatory city government. Now, what's this got to do with Father's Day and Mother's Day? I mean, Mother's Day. Well, I pray that God, it has to do with kingdom economics. You see, today, it's hard for a mother to be able to stay at home. Very hard, because they've been forced out into the workplace because of the economics. Back in the 50s, a man could work 50 hours a week, have his home paid for, and raise six children on one salary. And those children all had a mother to come home to. You remember those days, Margie? Bob? Cora, they were there. And people were happy. There was a gaiety out there. Today, we've got moms that are coming home. They're exhausted. They've got to grab fast food. They've worked hard. They've had to work hard because, well, the economics. This is Babylon. And so that young couple, when they come up the aisle, I pray that young man will have a job that he can, so she can maybe stay at home. And then the dangers that are out there. There are, if she's a halfway, she looks halfway better than a mud fence, there'll be all kinds of men coming around trying to seduce her along the way. Adultery, nobody has any fear of adultery in our society anymore. There, and then there's the diets. The diets are affecting the way people think. And the drug pushers out there. And the drug pushers, they aren't just the drug pushers on the street. The biggest drug pushers we got are the doctors. And that's affecting. I've seen homes destroyed by doctors. In fact, I got an email here. It says, I just listened to your message on repentance. I have to say that I agree with you on people getting to the point that they cannot repent. And I know why I was there. For years, the doctors had me on antidepressants and tranquilizers. Have you ever seen a woman hooked on tranquilizers? I have. I saw it at an early age. I got to the point that I didn't care what was right or wrong. That's what these drugs do to your mind. I stopped taking them in October of last year, and after I tried to end my life, Satan had completely taken over, and the doorway was with antidepressants. The doctors told me I would have to be on them the rest of my life. When I got the drugs out of my system, it was like waking up from a nightmare. When I look back on the person, it's hard for me to believe I was one of the ones that were able to repent. It was hard for me to believe. I was one of the ones that was able to repent. Thank God, my husband and your ministry, the prayers were powerful enough to make Satan lose his hold on me. My life now is very different. I believe that you do need to feel. If you are depressed, you just need to cry. If you are happy, laugh. I can feel again. I know when I'm right, and I know if I do something God doesn't want me to do. Thank you for taking time to read this. Is that encouraging to you? But I want you to know there are so many things. They've got to have economics right. They've got to have their health. God only knows how many women were killed in the 60s by overdose of birth control pills. They died right and left. Heart attacks and strokes. And James says, you know, you put to death the righteous and he does not resist. Satan is after the family. And then they'll attack the preacher that is trying to pray for those family units to come again. I could read more email here. You can see that I didn't do an over hard job of preparing. I thought I'd just rely on some of the emails I got. One lady wrote to me and told me what happened to her daughter on this medicine. She said in the email, I should have listened to my gut and I should have listened to Pastor Peters. You be careful. And then, well, where do I want to go next? Would you like to see a picture of my mother? Let's see if you got that. Can you show them? This is my mother. That was her. Happy Mother's Day, Mom. And I don't remember her a lot like that, but if I go way back in my memory, I can kind of remember her like that. Let me tell you about her. She started getting depression, bad circulation. It wasn't long after I was born, I guess. And make kind of a long story short, I didn't have a real happy childhood, I can tell you that. And I didn't have much in the way of a mother in my childhood. It was like maybe she was there part of the time. Most of the time she's either in a hospital or someplace. But our people have been taken in by this AMA for a long time. And I can still remember hearing my daddy say, they're both dead now, so I can tell this story, but he's more than once said, I wish to God I had never done it. He took her to Denver and had a bunch of tests done, and these doctors said there was a new treatment out. They couldn't find anything physiologically wrong. They thought it was psychological. And they had a new treatment out called shock treatments. And my mother and father submitted to the shock treatments. And as a result of that, it was just downhill from there. From there, it was tranquilizers and alcohol. What I remember my mother is, I remember her fingers. They were just as yellow as could be right here. Because she smoked cigarettes, and then when the one was down to the very filter, she'd take another one and light it off of that one. And I smoked more secondhand smoke than any bartender in the world by the time I was 10 years old. The house was always full of smoke. And she sat and just stared, depressed. And her fingers yellow from the nicotine. Somebody had gotten her smoking along the way. And on top of that, she became alcoholic. I can tell you stories. I can remember one October night, it was cold. I was locked out of the house and beating on the window trying to get her to let me in. And I finally had to crawl in the car and wait for my dad to come home because she was out of it. And you never knew with an alcoholic if she's what you're going to come home to. You just never know. Tranquilizers. She had to have tranquilizers all the time. She was only supposed to have so many. And she would just hound my dad for more tranquilizers. So I know what the dangers are out there. I've been in the ministry long enough to see mothers taken down by medical doctors. I know what that AMA is. And I've seen mothers taken out by the demons that begin to talk to her and say, hey, wouldn't you like to have a glamorous world? You don't want to just be a mom. We saw it right in this church. A young girl that I saw grow up, come to church here. I married her and her husband. And one day, she wasn't fulfilled anymore. Does this seem like it'd be a pattern that you've seen across this country? It's all over this country. These are spiritual truths on Mother's Day that I felt inclined to bring. I want you to now have this spiritual truth. It's in Ephesians chapter 6. Because there's a lot of families that have been broken up. And now Satan, after he breaks up the mother and father, he goes after the children. And this is how he does it. See, not all of this is a pretty Mother's Day picture, is it? I want beautiful Mother's Days for children in the future. But the children of broken homes, now Satan is after them. Let's read the scripture. It's in Ephesians chapter 6, 2 and 3. And I'll tell you a story on this one. I think I've got time. It says, honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise, that it may be well with you, that you may live long on the earth. Oh, I tell you, I've seen this happen. Now, there'll be a Father's Day. I'll get to the Jezmails. I want to tell you, in this line that I preach, there's a whole lot of men that are a bunch of lazy bums. They don't want to work, and they use Babylon as an excuse. And so their family lives in poverty because they're nothing but a bunch of bums. Because they don't want to take a number, or they don't want to do this, they don't want that, you lousy bums. I know what you are. You got bums on one side of the equation and bumettes on the other side. Now, I'm not going to discriminate on either side. Now, where was I? If you got a bum for a father, you honor him. And if you got a bumette for a mother, you honor her. Because you didn't walk in their shoes, and you remember this, you wouldn't be here if it wasn't for them. And what Satan does is, after there's been a broken home, then the divorced mother will turn on the children and say, your daddy's nothing but a bum. or it'll be vice versa. All I can say is that for some of you broken homes out there, you make sure, regardless of what the mate did to you, that you tell your children, you don't have to honor the dishonorable things your mother has done. Or you don't have to honor the dishonorable things your father has done, but you honor your father and you honor your mother because our Heavenly Father said to do it, and that's how you honor Him. And if you don't do it, it won't go well with you, and your days won't be long on this earth. Can you receive that? That's the way it is, and it's got to be taught. But I've seen the bitterness of broken homes, either on the father's side or the mother's side, and they put that poison into the child. I could tell you a story. I'll tell you the story. It was my first wife, and her mother and father were divorced when she was a little girl, and all she ever heard was what a rotten, no good count her father was. And when her brother died, about 30-some years old in a truck wreck, the mother didn't call the father. He was reading about it in the paper in the obituaries. That's a terrible thing to do. The boy was quite a bit older than his sister, and he had had the boy. And he called up, and my wife got the phone. She said, "I don't want you at my brother's funeral." And he said, "Well, honey, I won't come if you'll do me a favor. Come see me." Well, we went to see him, and she jumped him. She said, "You did this and that, you didn't support him." He said, like the blank he had, found out it was a whole different story. Showed the support papers, he was a war hero. You see, there was two sides to that story. And it was a bad thing to do to that little girl because she had been taught not to honor her father. You see what I'm saying? So I'm just saying, you know, you love your mother. You don't always know what all the circumstances were that made her do what she did. You don't. You don't know the diet. You don't know the drugs. You don't know the demons that come in. The whole works. You don't have to honor the dishonorable things, but you honor them. Can you receive that? I can tell you a story. It's kind of a tearjerker. Can you handle a tearjerker? Or do you want me to end on a happy note? You want a happy note or do you want a true tearjerker story? All right. Tearjerkers went out. I cried at my mother's casket. I was almost embarrassed to do it. We never said in our household, "I love you." And at the end of this whole horrible mess, my dad had finally had it. Said he wanted a divorce. They were separated at the time. My mother got ill. She was in a hospital in Omaha, and my Aunt Winnie got me on the train with her. Went to see her. My Aunt Winnie never had children. She wasn't a strong person. She relied on me like I was a man. I was only 13. But I sucked her up, and when I went to see my mom, she'd had two surgeries that night, and they'd found a blood clot in her leg, and they told us they were going to have to cut her leg off, and my Aunt Winnie was going to pieces on me. And I'd stand there, and I'd say to my mom, "You're going to get well, Mom." And she'd say, "No, Daddy doesn't love me anymore." Well, I had written her a letter about 5 days earlier, and I said, "Mom," in the letter, I said, "Mom, I love you." And I remember standing there, and I kept thinking, I need to tell her, "Mom, I love her." That's why I think Babylon Day, Mother's Day, is good, because at least you say, "Mom, I love you." I left that day. I didn't say it. But I always felt good because I at least wrote it in a letter to her. She died, and I was about 13. I remember they sent all of her stuff back from the hospital. One day I was going through it, and I found that letter. It had never been opened. I always felt pretty bad about that. So I say to you, don't just call Mom when you need her. You call her and you tell her, Mom, I love you. Can you receive that? Mother's Day is a good day because mothers need to hear it. Mom, I love you. I wish I'd have told her. So I'm telling you, you tell your mom you love her, and we're out of time. May the Lord Jesus Christ bless those of you that are His. Bless you and keep you. Make His face shine upon you, be gracious to you. Lift His countenance upon you and grant you peace. In Jesus' name, amen.
The preceding message by circuit riding preacher Peter Peters from the LaPorte Church of Christ, located at the base of the beautiful Colorado Rocky Mountains in LaPorte, Colorado, has been aired on the Scripture for America Worldwide Broadcasting Network and is available on CD or DVD and is archived at the website scripturesforamerica.org. Remember, circuit rider, preacher, and teacher Peter Peters broadcasts live nightly from his Wyoming radio ranch, nestled in the Laramie, Wyoming River Valley. It's a working horse and cattle ranch where circuit riding preacher Dr. Peters reaches the lost sheep of the House of Israel worldwide on satellite, internet, and shortwave radio. Dial settings 5755 and 9480. Check out the 24-hour, 7 days a week web broadcasting website, sfawbn.com. Scriptures for America Worldwide Broadcasting Network is made possible by the prayers and tithes of the faithful. If you want to write to circuit riding preacher Peter Peters, the address is Scriptures for America, P.O. Box 766, LaPorte, Colorado, 80535. Or you can visit us on the web at www.scripturesforamerica.org. The preacher will be riding back this way next week and hopes you will too.
Kiss the hand that led you, hold to His unchanging. coaching hand. Build your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand.
I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came. Precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is due Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about His healing, of His cleansing power revealing, how He made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is due Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion He's built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is due Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
Well, today I'm so weary. Today I'm so blue, sad and brokenhearted for not loving you. Life was a gift, Lord, but I lived it all wrong. Now I know it's in Your arms I belong. And I pledge all my love for Jesus my King, all for Him who died for me. I'm a man who gives his life, and every other thing, all for the love of a King. And I pledge all my love for Jesus my King. All